Hey everybody, it's Camera Tim, and I'm going to show you how to make a PNG logo into a 3D logo directly inside of DaVinci Resolve and stuff. Now, up until now, you've had to use some sort of online converter to convert a PNG to SVG, and then you've had to do some roundabout workarounds to copy mask data from one thing to another. I'm getting rid of all of that today, because I've discovered two scripts that'll completely eliminate both intensive processes. The first tool, if you've been using Fusion long enough, you probably know about. It's called Reactor, but there's a certain effect inside of Reactor that we're going to look at today. It's called VectorSnapshot. And the second script that we're going to look at, something that not many people have known about apparently, is sPolygon Converter. Links to both of these pages will be in the description. And I'm going to show you quickly how to install them so that we can get right into it. Reactor is actually pretty simple to install. You just click and drag the LUA file into Fusion, and you'll get this pop-up window with the option to install and launch it. And then once you have Reactor installed, you're actually going to go up to Workspace. You can go down to Scripts, and you can actually open Reactor from here. It might automatically open it up for you when you first install it, so this might not be a necessary step. But once you have it open, you can search for Vector Snapshot. And you'll want to check this box and then hit install. Once that's done, you might have to close and reopen Resolve. But that should show up under Scripts, Andrew Hazelden. Thank you, Andrew. And Vector Snapshot. And for the sPolygon script, you're going to want to put it into this folder right here. Although if for some reason this doesn't make it show up, you can also try to go to the Reactor Deploy and Scripts and utility folder inside of here. I've had this work too when the other one wasn't working, just in case. But in general, this folder should work. And then on a Mac, this whole file format is pretty similar, except you go to the library, application support, and then you follow the rest of the path the same. And now that we've got those things in place, we can then go ahead and bring in our PNG logo. So I'm just gonna go ahead and make a new Fusion composition in here. Going to open it up, and then we're going to drag our logo inside of it. And then to load images into viewers or load nodes into viewers, just press the numbers 1 and 2. But the first image viewer is the key one. With the vector snapshot, really all we're looking for is just to get mask data. So in order to get the mask data correct, we want everything to be solid white. So the easy way to do that in this scenario is we're going to go ahead and just bring in a brightness contrast node. We're going to load that into the first viewer. And then we're going to check pre-divide post-multiply so that anything that is an alpha channel stays an alpha channel. And then we're going to bring lift to 1, and that'll make everything solid white. So now that we have this loaded into the first viewer, let's make sure we click inside of the first viewer. That is a necessary step. I've tested this. And then we can go up to Workspace, Scripts, Andrew Hazelden, and then Vector Snapshot. We click on that, and that's going to make our SVG right here. And also, if it doesn't create this SVG on the first try, go ahead and try it again, because sometimes it doesn't create the SVG for some reason, but most of the time it should work. And before we close out of this window, let's just go ahead and click in our window right here and make sure we copy our full file path. We're going to copy that, and then we can go ahead and close this out. And now we can go up to Fusion, Import, SVG. And then I already have it pulled up right here, but just in case, you can just go in here, paste it, and then press enter, and that'll take you directly to that folder where the SVG is. So now we can just click on it, hit open, and then the width and height we don't have to worry about. We can hit okay. And now if we preview this into the first viewer, we can see we have our mask data. If we double click and open it, we can see all the masks that it created. I'm gonna go ahead and shrink down my media pool here. Now, in order for the sPolygon to work, we need to delete all of our background and merge nodes because all we need is the mask data, not anything else. Just delete them. It also feels good. But now we're going to head and just click on the group itself, then go up to Workspace, Scripts, and sPolygon. And we just made magic. If I click on the sMerge, bring it up to the first viewer, whoa! What happened here? How do we fix this? I will tell you. So now, if we click on sMerge, we can press Shift Space, and we're going to search for sTransform. So we can bring that in, press 1 to bring that into the first viewer, and I already know basically the size that this is supposed to be, but in case you don't, what you can do is go up to your original Brightness Contrast node, and before you load that into the first viewer, go up to where this says buffer A. If it's not set to buffer A, make sure it's set to buffer A so that you can set the transform into that. And then we click our binder's contrast, go up here, go to buffer B, and then press 1 again. Now, if we go to our buffer split wipe, we can then wipe back and forth between them so that we can see both of them and compare the sizes. So now let's just go back to our sTransform here and then bring down the size until we have it basically where it should be, which for me is roughly around here. The scaling might not perfectly match, but you know, we're getting there. But as long as it looks like it'll scale correctly, that's all that matters in this case. Now that we have that done, there's another issue we have here. Now, this is typically where you could just press shift space and then type in extrude 3D and just hit enter. And then we can go ahead and bring this into the first viewer. And normally you could just go extrusion depth. However, we notice a problem. There's no holes. So how do we fix that? Well, if we look at our masks here, let's go ahead and just click on the sTransform 1 and bring that back into the first viewer. I'm also just going to nix this group because we actually have absolutely no use for it anymore. And I like cleaner stuff. Just kidding. Anybody that's seen any of my fusion stuff will get an aneurysm. But the reason we're seeing what we are is because there's no distinction with these masks telling it what's subtractive and what's additive. So it just thinks everything's the same once it goes into the extrude 3D and we get no gaps. So in order to fix that, let's just go in and we can click on each mask and it'll show us a preview of what that mask is doing. And for every subtractive mask that we find, we can just make sure it's separated. And we can also highlight multiples and see multiple masks highlighted. So we can just speed that process up. And then this last little tag here, I'm probably just not even going to keep. So I'm just going to delete those masks. But now that we have them separated, what I can do is I can highlight them all and then press and hold shift and then just click and let go while holding shift. And now that those are separated, now we're seeing what the extrude 3D is actually seeing. And this is the step that we need to fix. And let's just make our tree cleaner here just so it's easier for me to show. So now we have our subtractive masks here and we just need to make another merge. We could even just click and copy and paste if we wanted to, so we don't have to shift space again. And we can just drag all of these masks into this new merge. And if we preview this one, we can see we have all our subtractive masks here. And of course, this is before it goes into the transform. Don't worry about that. So now, before this transform, we're actually going to click on this first merge here. And then we're going to shift space once again. And we are going to add an sBoolean. Now, what is a Boolean? A Boolean is just a coding term to determine if something is true or false, and then what to do with that information. So in this case, on the Boolean, we actually just want to set operation to subtract so that anything that goes into it will be a subtractive mask. So we drag this in, and now we have our holes cut back out again. And if we go back into the extrude 3D, we now see that we have our gaps inside of our letters again. And if we go up to our lighting and turn on lights and shadows, we can get an even better picture of that. And now we have a 3D logo. We can even add some depth here if we wanted to, just for some fun stylizing-ish. But now if we actually wanted to get this to scale properly or incorporate the correct colors, we need to put the image back into it. Now, how do we do that cleanly? We can actually go back up to our original media in, click, hold shift so it can disconnect, let go, and then we can actually just drag this into the extrude 3D. And it seems to work, except, whoa, what happened here? How do we fix that? Pretty simple. So this is just a texture input, essentially, or a material input, as it were. So this doesn't actually affect the sizing of anything that we're putting into the extrude 3D. This is just telling us what kind of material we're using. So we can just use something like an erode dilate node. And then we can just use circle because I like circle a little bit better. And essentially what this is doing is just increasing our edges here and just really thickening it out. But that's okay, because now if we look at our extrude 3D, everything is filled in a lot more properly. And on the extrude 3D, we can increase our smoothing angle so everything looks a bit cleaner and just gives off a smoother vibe. But now that we have our logo, we can go ahead and put that into a merge 3D. We can add lighting and actually do real lighting on it. So if I pull in this merge, and I can also add a render 3D, and there's plenty of tutorials on how to do all of this. But essentially what we can do, and I'm breezing through this, but if I preview my render 3D here in the second viewer or in the media out, we now have a 3D logo. And don't forget to get the camera. And that's essentially the first way in how to get a PNG image into a 3D logo. Now let's say your PNG logo didn't have an alpha channel and you're working with something that had somewhat of a textured background. Like this. I can't cover every single use case in this one example, obviously, but there are a number of things we can do. Like we can use a combination of brightness contrast. We can use luma keyers to try to remove some of this background or separate it. We can use invert color in case the logo is actually darker than the background. But essentially in this instance, we can just try to do our brightness and contrast adjustments. We can just move this threshold. Let's make sure it's on the first viewer so we can actually bring this down. And again, we're not looking to get a perfect key here, a perfect look. We just want the mask data. So I'm going to put this pretty high so that we maintain most of the information that we need to. And then the luma key has a much easier job of just cutting things out. And I can just bring the high down so that it only keeps in what we need to. And maybe I went a little too aggressive here. Keep some of that back in. And then I can add a brightness and contrast afterwards. And then we do the same trick we did before. Pre-divide, post-multiply, and bring left all the way up. And if I bring that into the first viewer, we have our whiteness. So let's go ahead and with that in the first viewer, click in the first viewer, go ahead to workspace, scripts, Andrew Hazelden, vector snapshot, and we have our SVG. So let's go ahead and go into Fusion, import SVG, bring in that new one that we just made, and it does it again. It's not even a mask. It's getting worse. If you are having issues and the masks aren't coming in as the correct resolution or things aren't working the way they should, as is in this case, if you've tried importing that SVG and it's just not working properly, what you can do is actually just directly bring in the BMP file. So we're going to go ahead and do that. And I can load that into the first viewer, click on it, go to workspace, scripts, do the same thing, and make a vector snapshot of the BMP file, which then should give us a much more accurate SVG. So let's go ahead and test that because it's using it as a loader. So let's go ahead and import SVG and then click on the loader version, hit open, width and height are correct, hit OK. And now if I preview this, now we have our image with all of our masks properly loaded. And once again, if we need to go in and do individual removal of these masks, we can also do that just to get rid of all the stuff we don't need. Or we can go in and refine our keying and brightness contrast and do all that stuff if we need to. And then we can just go ahead and do the same process of removing all the background and merge nodes like so. And then we can go ahead and go over to workspace, scripts, sPolygon, or sPolygon, whatever it's called. And when we preview that, we have our logo here. And then we just do the same process we did before. And then additionally, we can still use our original media in and just run a road dilate through it once again, just to get the same or similar material we want out of the image. And we can check that with our 3D extruded logo here. If we just plug this in, and then we realize sometimes it doesn't fit quite right in there either. But thankfully, I've come up with a transform that does do the job just fine, so it gets where we need to go. And now we have an extruded 3D logo that we made from bits and pieces. So obviously 3D extrusion is never perfect, but there are ways we can work around it. And hopefully this gave you some ideas and inspiration on how to work around those things and get the 3D effects that you were looking for. If you have any additional questions or if there's something I didn't cover or there's a better way to do this that I don't know about, please leave it in the comments and I would love to hear about it. And I would love to hear what you're making with this stuff too. If you want to see even more crazy things that you can do in Fusion, check out this video on thumbnails, where I simplify the four steps to creating pretty much any thumbnail out there. Click it, give it a click. If you click on it, your dreams may just come true. I can't guarantee it, but you never know. I'm signing out. Bye. I'm what you call a 3D model. Okay, no, don't clip that. I'm gone.